Hello everyone. In this video, I'll be discussing power dissipation in CMOS circuits. In CMOS designs, power is drawn from the supply and eventually dissipated as heat. Understanding the sources of this power dissipation is crucial for efficient circuit design. Power dissipation in CMOS circuits can be classified into two main categories: dynamic power dissipation and static power dissipation. Dynamic power dissipation occurs during the switching activity of a circuit and can be divided into two main components: switching power and short circuit power. Both of these sources of power dissipation in CMOS circuits are related to the transition at input gate, and for that reason are usually referred as dynamic power dissipation. Static or leakage power dissipation occurs even when the circuit is idle, primarily due to leakage currents. It has three main contributors: subthreshold leakage current, gate leakage current, reversed biased PN junction current. Let's look at switching power in detail. Switching power dissipation in CMOS circuits refers to the energy dissipated when the load capacitance is charged or discharged during circuit switching, as the output node toggles between high and low states. In this picture, we have an inverter circuit with an input signal VIN and output signal VOUT. The power supply voltages are VDD and ground. The capacitive load and the output node VOUT is denoted as C load. When the input toggles from 1 to 0, a current flows from the power supply VDD through the PMOS transistor, charging the capacitive load. Conversely, when the input toggles from 0 to 1, the charge stored in the capacitor discharges through the current flowing from the capacitor to the NMOS transistor, finally to the ground. This charging and discharging of the load capacitance during switching leads to power dissipation. Let's go step by step to understand energy dissipation that occurs in both the PMOS and NMOS transistors. To find the energy dissipation in PMOS during charging, first we calculate the instantaneous power, which is the product of the charging current I charging and output voltage V out. Then the energy dissipated is obtained by integrating the instantaneous power over charging duration time from t equals to 0 to t equals to r time, where r time is the time it takes for V out to rise from 0 to VDD. Now let's substitute the value of power here with I charging times V out. We can rewrite the I charging as C load times dV out by dt. Further, we simplify the integral and change the variable of integration from time to voltage. After solving, the integral evaluates to half C load VDD square. In similar fashion, we can compute the energy dissipated in NMOS during discharging, and that is also half C load times VDD square. Let's summarize what we learned from switching power dissipation computations. The total switching power drawn from the power supply is given as C load VDD square. During charging cycle, when the input transitions from 1 to 0, the capacitor charges, storing half C load VDD square as potential energy. During this process, the PMOS transistor dissipates an equivalent amount, half C load VDD square, as heat. During discharging cycle, when the input transitions from 0 to 1, the capacitor discharges to 0 volt. This results in half C load VDD square being dissipated as heat through NMOS transistor. To accurately characterize the energy dissipation in switching at a node, we need to consider how often the switching occurs. Switching events depend on the node's activity during operation. The power dissipated due to switching at a node can be written as F 0 to 1 times C load VDD square. The term F 0 to 1 represents the frequency of 0 to 1 transitions at the node. Further, we can express F 0 to 1 in terms of switching activity factor denoted by AF and clock frequency. Switching activity factor AF is the probability of a 0 to 1 transition in a clock cycle. Finally, the switching power equation can be expressed as AF times F clock C load VDD square. This equation provides a comprehensive way to calculate switching power, factoring in the node activity, clock frequency, capacitance, and voltage. Now let's look at short circuit power. Short circuit power dissipation occurs due to a brief current flow from VDD to ground during input transitions. This happens when both the NMOS and PMOS are on simultaneously, creating a direct current path between the supply and ground. Depending on the transitions, whether the output is rising from 0 to 1 or falling from 1 to 0, short circuit current is measured differently in simulation. When the output transitions from 0 to 1, the short circuit current is measured as the point NC denoted in the picture, and it is measured at point ND when the output transitions from 1 to 0. By isolating these points during charging and discharging, we ensure that the switching currents are excluded from the measurements. Once the current values are obtained, in theory, power can be calculated as V times I. However, this calculation is not precise for short circuit power because of the transistors. Drain to source voltages are not constant during transitions. Simulation engines use sophisticated techniques to compute accurate short circuit power. Here is the graph illustrating how the inverted input signal Vin varies over time and its relevance to short circuit power dissipation. As the input voltage Vin transitions over time, there is a specific range where both the NMOS and PMOS transistors are conducting, establishing a direct path from VDD to ground. This results in short circuit current contributing to power loss. The short circuit current depends on the rise and fall time of the input signals. Longer rise and fall times increase the duration for which both transistors are on, leading to higher short circuit power. Larger load capacitance can also affect transitions, indirectly influencing short circuit current. Now let's talk about static power consumption in CMOS circuits. We'll discuss three main contributors: subthreshold leakage current, gate tunneling current, reverse bias PN junction leakage current. First, the subthreshold leakage current. Subthreshold current is the current that flows between drain and source when a transistor operates in weak inversion region, that is, when the gate voltage is below the threshold voltage. For instance, in an inverter circuit, it is typically assumed that when the input voltage is zero, the NMOS transistor is off and there is no current flow through it. However, in reality, a small subthreshold leakage current still exists through the NMOS transistor in this state. Therefore, when the NMOS is in weak inversion region, there is a direct path from VDD to ground, leading to leakage power consumption. Let's understand it from device physics perspective. In weak inversion region, there is no gate-induced electric field, but there is a small longitudinal field under the gate due to drain voltage. This allows some of the energetic electrons at source to enter the channel and diffuse towards the drain, creating a small leakage current. With modern technology scaling, the supply voltage or VDD is reduced to minimize dynamic power consumption. In order to maintain drive strength at these supply voltages, the threshold voltages for PMOS and NMOS are also scaled. However, reducing threshold leads to an exponential increase in subthreshold leakage current as the transistor becomes more prone to leakage in weak inversion. The dependence of subthreshold leakage current on threshold voltage can be given with this relationship. In this equation, Vt is thermal voltage, which is given as Kt over Q. Here, K is Boltzmann constant, T is temperature, and Q is the charge of an electron. Eta, that is slow factor, is given as 1 plus depletion capacitance over oxide capacitance. Now let's talk about gate tunneling leakage current. Gate oxide leakage is caused due to the current generated by the tunneling of electrons through the thin gate oxide layer in MOSFETs. Let's understand how this phenomena occurs. With each successive technology generation, the oxide thickness in MOSFETs must be reduced to mitigate short channel effects and to improve the gate control over channel. However, aggressive scaling of oxide thickness creates a high electric field in channel, which leads to electrons and hole tunneling from the bulk and source drain overlap region through the gate oxide potential barrier into the gate. This results in tunneling current. Unlike subthreshold leakage, which happens only when the transistor is off or in weak inversion region, gate oxide leakage occurs both when the transistor is on and off. When the transistor is off, the leakage current flows through the overlap regions of the source and drain. When the transistor is on, the leakage current flows through the overlap regions and the transistor channel, making it generally higher in this case. Reverse bias PN junction leakage current. Reverse bias junction leakage occurs due to the current that flows in the reverse bias PN junctions in a transistor. In this case, when a junction is reverse bias, the current is primarily caused by thermally generated minority carriers, electrons on the P side and holes in the N side. This leakage current increases with temperature because higher temperatures produce more thermally generated minority carriers. So far, we have discussed some of the most significant sources of power dissipation in CMOS circuits. Now, let's touch on another important term, internal power. Internal power in a circuit refers to the power consumed internally within the circuit, excluding any power required to drive external capacitive loads. It is an essential component of the total power dissipation in a circuit, and it is commonly characterized as part of standard cell, which are the fundamental building blocks of IC designs. There are two key components of internal power, short circuit power. As discussed earlier, this dissipation occurs during input transitions when both NMOS and PMOS transistors in a CMOS circuit conduct simultaneously for a brief moment. In this case, a direct current path between supply voltage, VDD, and ground leads to power dissipation. The other part of internal power is parasitic capacitance charging power. This is the power spent in charging and discharging parasitic capacitances inherent to the design. These parasitics include internal node capacitances, which arise from transistor gates, diffusion regions, and wiring within the circuit. The picture here shows the capacitances intrinsic to an NMOS. Internal power is important as it provides insight into the intrinsic efficiency of a circuit, separate from external factors like load capacitance. Reducing internal power is critical for achieving low power operation in modern energy-efficient IC designs. This brings us to the end of the video. I hope this presentation provided you with valuable insights into energy dissipation in transistor circuits.